then it's my pleasure really to welcome Dr. Sharma, Samin Sharma, and Dr. Annapurna Kini from Mount Sinai Hospital in New York. And they are our family, and they always are here for us and show us amazing cases. Dr. Dangas, their colleague, is here. So, you know, we are ready for some fun here. Samin, take it away.
All right. Jaswinder, fantastic. We are getting a positive notes from Dangas is there and few other friends. Arthur Reitman, and so he told me that he is going in person. And I'm so thankful to you that everybody is kind of fed up with the Zoom meetings and you are making an in-person meeting. Fantastic, and congratulations for, we'll follow the same lead for our June meeting. And clearly welcome from Mount Sinai Cath Lab, myself, Annu on the left side, and then we have our fellows on the right side and ready to start the case with the knowing that we have 45 minutes and it's a very complex case along with my Cath Lab staff. So if we can, and I know your panelists are, some of them are coming, some may be on Zoom, but I think for sake of time, we can start a slide presentation and take through, because, well, brief presentation of the case. Again, greetings from Mount Sinai. And these are our disclosures, which is nothing new. And as you mentioned, live case number 7. And you did tell me that this will be the Impala case. So I said we kept that patient for you to show, 67-year-old male. And this patient presents with multiple heart failure admissions and non-compliant. Goes to hospitals for last few years, goes home, does not follow further treatment advice as well as medication. He was admitted now on 1st of this month in gross heart failure to the emergency room, and EF was 12%. So it's a clearly reduced ejection fraction, and here echo also revealed torrential TR and MR. Patient was optimized, and then after 10 days of optimization underwent cath, and we'll show you that. This patient also had an MR, cardiac MRI in the past, which showed dilated cardiomyopathy, ischemic cardiomyopathy with patchy areas of viability in inferior and anterior areas, and a lot of necrosis. Was put before came to the cath lab, was on appropriate medications or carbidolol, furosemide, Entresto, Aldactone, Torvastatin. Originally was on dobutamine and so when he was admitted, but then really stabilized, and now going to show from the angiogram point of view, extensive CAD. This is the first time this patient getting the cardiac catheterization. Anu?
Yeah, so you see the right coronary artery, he actually had 3 vessel disease. You already see the stents in the mid RCA and the AV continuation to the large second RPL. That's where we see the disease. Now he has, almost like a dual PDA, but one of the first PDA you see was a small size, subtotal, and you see it filling from the left system as this is how it sees in the cranial view. We did that. They look
good. 2 stents were done in the RCA. Yeah.
So left main is essentially, I would say, non-obstructive, less than 30%. So circ is small. There's an LPL significant disease, small size, but a large, I would say moderate to large size ramus, which has significant disease. But this is where the entire coronary artery disease false. This is LAD. So prox LAD, moderate diffuse, but then you have significant disease in the mid LAD where you have a large diagonal that's taking off, and after that the distal LAD is totally occluded, but you do see some flow.
Okay, go to the LV, and this is the one, as I said, now after the RCA PCI, EF from 12 on echo became 18, and torrential MRs and TR became severe. So no longer torrential, now 3, 4+. And this is patient now, EDP was 30, yeah. Gave some diuretic, and we have put an Impala appropriate for this particular case to deal with this complex anatomy.
Okay, that's where we are.
So now we can ask our panelists how they will handle it. So we felt that the LED is probably now after
RCA. Indeed, great vibes here in the live ARCH symposium. And it's finally time to have a connection with Mount Sinai, with my hospital group there, the super experts of the complex PCI. Good. Let me say from the get-go that whenever I hear 10% by echo, I cut that by half. So initially it was a 6% EF, and afterwards it became maybe 5. So anyhow, maybe double digits now, super high risk case, and no question that hopefully after this success, perhaps the patient is going to go ahead to some kind of a valve interventions if possible as well.
Yeah.
But we'll see.
No, that's a very good point. If we can continue my slide so that I can complete that. So that's a very important point in this case. This is the case knowing that came with a heart. During that time, patient had a surgical consultation, heart failure attending consultation, cardiologist. They recommended patient likely will need heart transplant. But said, let's do the PCI and see what happens. And that's where we are now. As you see that multiple, and it makes it from our appropriate criteria with a three-vessel disease. And after heart team discussion will be appropriate. And I think Impella also, what we have taught for everyone based on the LV function, complexity of the CAD, it will fall into the middle category where you need to use Impella to do a good full revascularization and not be worried about the hemodynamics. And that's where we are now. We can go live, please.
And also show the hemodynamics picture in picture side in the small. So, yeah, George, what is what should be our strategy here?
Not much calcium. Yeah.
Let's discuss here with the panel. Would ECMO become a possibility, or I guess some centers with this extreme EF maybe consider ECMO as well for this case? But
I think what we normally do in this, I think Samin and Anu, they are doing, I think Impella 3.5 is great. I really think even 2.5 is okay in this scenario. It is a chronic preconditioned heart. Even though EF is low, it's not an acute coronary syndrome. So I think patients usually tolerate it. But
to see where it is going.
Obviously, you need support. Oh. And I think Impella is okay. I think ECMO, not so much in terms of unloading the ventricle. I think, in terms of tandem heart, that was, Arthur, what do you think?
Well, I think similarly, the lack of acuity here is what should drive the decision making, as you said. The fact that the EDP is 30, not terrible, certainly a 3.5 plausible. I wonder whether a 5.0,
the run through. I think first I ought to make it.
Potentially a tandem, something along those lines, if necessary to recover in the CCU. But certainly they'll, I know,
And I think the key thing here also is viability, right? I mean, you look at the total occlusion distally,
the
heart is very, whatever type of viability you want to use. I mean, nuclear sometimes is limited in this. That is probably good. MR is good, like they did. So establishing viability and then attempting complex PCI with hemodynamic support is the way to go here.
Right. No, 100%. I don't think there would be anyone who would attempt this case just with a balloon pump, right?
Yes, no.
And
no
way. Clearly case not doable without support.
And another question comes that do you need just the LP, which is 2.5, or go with the CP, which is a 4 or 3.5 to 4.0. One of the advantages for CP we start using more is just because it's a single axis. And we want to show with the camera that you need in the puncture. You can see in the groin, if you can zoom a little bit, that not through the same aperture.
Yeah, no question. Yeah. The single axis makes a difference.
Yeah.
And
can
you show us exactly how the setup is? I would like to see that. Can you uncover the sheath a little bit? Uncover it so we can see how that goes.
But it's important to note that when you do, I know this is done very elegantly. It's important. You use, like AK and SS always teach us in terms of meticulous techniques, using a micropuncture to access to put the sheath in through which you're going to do the intervention and just making sure that.
You want to change to Fielder or Gaia?
Right place.
We'll go in.
The single puncture is amazing. So, Samin,
what do you want?
Can you just. A minute or so, can you just describe the single puncture for our audience?
Yeah, so very good point. So key is that, of course, you do a micropuncture. Some people will do ultrasound, which is okay also. That is what in the PROTECT IV, which is just starting. They're mandatory. They're making it, unless you have an angiogram of the iliofemoral, I mean CAT scan, you should do a ultrasound guided micropuncture. And this is what has been done in this particular case. And then, of course, you have two pre-closed sutures. Put your 14 French sheath, and you can use easily 7 French guide catheter, knowing that this case may require 2 stenting in the big diagonal and distal LED. And then, first, of course, you put your Impella, and then not through the same hole. You need to take a needle, and the puncture needle, and side make an aperture. The hole not through the same, because once you do same, then it will bleed quite a bit, because then you take away the valve function. So side by side, and they accommodate very well. Only thing is that you had, sometimes you may not be able to advance too much in terms of guide manipulation. It does create a problem in rarely, but most of the time you can use 6 or 7 French without any problem through the same sheath. So this is what has been done.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah. Also, it helps you if you use the short Impella sheath. If it's a long, maybe this friction will be a little bit of a problematic. And we usually use 5 or 45 length sheath through that. And it's okay if some part of the sheath is not all the way in the Impella, as we saw here, about 10 or so centimeters of the sheath are actually outside the Impella. That's fine. You don't need to put it all the way in. But the access, again, is through a puncture. And it's a good time to explain that, as Dr. Kinney tries to cross the occlusion later, and she's down in this LLAD, and she's working on that.
So yeah, we need a Gaia 2 or 3.
No, I have a fielder. I mean, initially you see that even in the proximal LAD, the fielder was just going into the septal. I changed to run through. I came up to distal LAD, and here I am with the fielder.
Fielder XT?
No, it's a regular fielder. Yeah. That's it.
Yeah, okay. You're able to get through? No, you need a little further. Yeah. So you know what? Fielder XT, I know there's a lot of people love the Fielder XT. What we found is Fielder XT is good, but then you cannot advance the catheter in this complex cases with any balloon or support.
Dynamics to the left side, to the bottom left side of the screen. Please move the hemodynamics to the left bottom side of the screen.
Good. You move the hemodynamics away from there. Yeah. Good.
Okay, beautiful. Using a fine cross or not a crosshair?
I have a fine cross, of course, you know, whatever you're comfortable with. That's what we always teach, that you use one over the, you know, this transit catheter, and just be comfortable with what you are. But of course, if you think there's calcium and you know that you have to puncture the proximal cap, and like a true CTO. Here we thought, we definitely, by looking at this, it was a subtotal to total, that we did not need aggressive wires, that it was okay going with the fine cross. Even fine cross has the capability where we can, twist, torque, and go further, but otherwise you should use any other catheters which are available.
So we looks like we have been in the distal vessel.
Yeah, of course.
And now we'll start with get a two balloon also. Yeah. We are going to, it was a fielder. Now we need to go back, need exchange, and require few intervention. Maybe the diagonal D3 or D2 will require.
So if you see there, I mean, the LAD is large. I think I have D2 is also a large vessel with significant disease, which we need to work on. And maybe D1, we have to leave it alone.
Yeah.
So AK, you know, consistent with your octate, your calcificate.
Calcificate.
So... not a whole lot in that vessel,
the
right?
In the second, D2.
No, I don't think we see any calcium. Of course, you know, angiographically, we don't see calcium at all. Yes. So, the same. I think if angiographically you don't see calcium, we don't need to, image at this time. Let's just dilate the vessel, get some flow into this LAD, and then decide. Now, when the EF is low, of course, we always consider. What?
Diagonal wire?
No, not yet. Let's dilate the lid. That we will always consider, should we do bifurcation stenting or just provisional stenting? Since the diagonal was not totally not occluded, right? I feel the lateral wall probably has probably more ischemia, more viable myocardium in the diagonal area rather than the apex.
Okay.
So this is a 2-0 balloon. I just compliant, make a room and then decide what balloon and stent size we are going to need here. Yeah. Well, now clearly happened these patients, yeah.
Yeah, I think, you know, they're going to angioplasty and then after that, you know, vasodilators and imaging. I think Dr. Kinney's point is very, very important. You know, your diagonal is big and it's open. LAD was occluded and there's patchy areas of viability. You do not want to compromise a large vessel that's open, right? So I think that's why I think your decision probably will be made that I think you probably have to revascularize the diagonal also. But
yeah,
I think
absolutely. Yes.
SS, for these kind of complex cases where the EF is as low as this AK, do you ever put a swan in to monitor, to see what's going on with the, there was torrential TR, you said torrential TR, just to see if something, you know, if anything deteriorates as you...
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. Actually, and that will be prospectively looked into it, the PROTECT 4 trial, that they will be the centers which will require routine hemodynamics are right-sided. In the cases, although we actually have not made our decision yet, because we don't do usually, but yes, that will be a one way to look into that. Many centers will, and part of the original our trial in the PROTECT 2, that these patients did require, you know, there are hemodynamics, as you know, in all of those trials require that the hemodynamics were done with a right heart cath. Although in routine practice, no. In this particular case, we knew that we had done the cath last time with high PA pressures and wedge pressures and so. Okay, let's keep doing. What is the plan now? I think we need a 2-point long balloon to open the mid LED.
2530.
Yeah.
I think we open up the primary distal lesion also. So I think long balloon will help and little vasodilators. You know, a little bit. I think pressure is a little borderline, but vasodilators, I think that LED may
open. In this, we should use nipride, and if nipride will be better. Otherwise, we use huge as a vasodilator. Verapamil is our routine, 250 microgram or 500. But in this particular case, we should have a nipride ready because with bad LV, that really caused more trouble.
Then what you want to do? Mini crush or leave this guy?
D2. AK. Yeah, D2 lil cut.
Yeah, we are going to do that right D2, now. I think we'll open the LED and then we'll this.
I think the question of measuring hemodynamics and LVEDP is crucial here. Because, you know, not only two things. One, you have contrast nephropathy. There is data that if you measure EDP and base your hydration based on EDP, you have significant reduction in acute kidney injury. So LVPD, and not only that, with hemodynamic support, where you tailor it, measuring EDP like they did beforehand, and then monitoring with the impeller is a very, very good habit. It just takes a few seconds, so very important to do that.
And the newer impeller will have the LVEDP constant monitoring, which they are working on.
Awesome.
Get me a fielder, right? What's the other wire you have?
Fielder. We should put fielder in the diagonal. And diagonal cut with the ostium, here.
Okay, yeah. Yeah,
2.25 Wolverine. Yeah,
2.5. No? It's a large diagonal.
Okay.
2.5.
So this is the 2.530 balloon, which we are dilating at various pressures from 10 to 20 millimeter of mercury to just open up our... all the vasculature. You want to see it?
I think the LED probably is better open now.
We are not gone vasodilators yet.
Mm.
Yeah. Okay. But we can give a little nipride also, as Jacinda said. Yeah. We'll give a little nipride.
The other thing that's kind of interesting, AK, I mean, do you think that you see sort of the distal half of the heart, even though the EF is as low as it is? On fluoro right now, you can see sort of the distal half of the heart starting to move a little bit. It's maybe it's just the impella, but it doesn't. The ventriculogram looked terrible. It doesn't look quite as bad as it.
Actually, you know the part time to time when you'll see the hemodynamics post PVC. You know, back when I started my fellowship in 1989-90, we used to count on the ventriculogram post-PVC potentiation. Look at the post-PVC blood pressure. Goes to 120, yes. 130, it's a post-PVC, yes. So it speaks to me there will be a lot of viability. Just by opening the RCA, which was not subtotal, LED is subtotal to total, I expect more gain in this particular case. Yeah. We actually had we presented the case about a month ago. Patient came with an ejection fraction of 18. I did 3-vessel PCI. EF became 55. Same chronic ischemic cardiomyopathy. And the patient which presented, that young guy. But this one is probably much more chronic than anything else. Okay. Yeah.
I think your balloon, you know, I'll tell you, I think the LED is bigger than what you think. And you have a little dissection at the primary lesion site. So
right.
The two things you do is, like they're doing, you give vasodilators and then see what it looks like. And then the next thing you do is imaging. And I think with opening up a little further the dissection, I think your artery is going to start looking better. So this is a great case.
You have to pull back a little more. Yeah.
We talk about this all the time, AK. I mean, do you think that if was a little calcium, would rotational atherectomy have prevented some of the snow plowing into that you may see in a diagonal like this? I mean, is there any validity to that?
Well, actually, you know what? Even in the MACE trial, when it was moderate calcium, it did rota. Actually, outcomes were worse. So this will fall into the moderate category. That study we are not published yet. But if you did all those 350 cases, when moderate rotation atherectomy was done in about 18% of cases, severe was done in 33%. Rotablation in severe calcium, 33% got the rota.
No, but I think we need to go with the fine cross because the tip of the wire is probably destroyed trying to get here.
Okay.
Cannot get into the diag.
So let's go back into the fine cross and new wire. Yeah. No, I think this one we can point it now to the dissections have been created with the balloon.
Where the septal is, it's very difficult to get into the LED and then it forms a curve.
Exactly. Even for the first time I had to use the run-through, and run-through, you know, is the one that went to the distal, mid to distal LED. Now the tip of this...
Should we get another run-through?
But I think we need a fine cross just to be sure.
Yeah, fine cross and run-through.
That the tip is not destroyed, trying to reach there.
Yeah, that's a new one, yeah.
Huge band, take a run through. Band and with a micro catheter, I think that might be better.
Exactly.
And the question of rotational atherectomy also is that the runoff is poor distally. So you run the risk of no reflow here, number one. And number two also is, if you say it didn't have hemodynamics and stuff, it actually, when you do rotational atherectomy...
The wire before the balloon, now the dissection.
Yeah.
I told you.
Actually, the LV transiently, because it gets absorbed in the reticuloendothelial system, it takes probably 2 hours to really bounce back. And this patient doesn't have the reserve. So that's one of the beauties about Impella in this setting is you allow them to bounce back. So
quickly.
Yes.
Good. Yep.
Get me the run through. You have a nice curve. Check the curve.
Yep.
Oh, again 300?
No, short.
How can we take this out? How do we take this out?
We can take out right now. It's okay. Good. Let's go into the diagonal. So, this is the fielder earlier, and now we are going with the run-through. Because we got so used to this run-through, although in always the side branches and so talked about using run-through, but in this particular case, get the dark also. So one of the lesson here is that the diagonal before doing the PCI, because now we are going through many of those channels, the dissected channel, the diagonal should have been wired. So you know, always no matter how many times you do the cases, you always have a learning point. And the learning point on the audience and those who are on the Zoom and there, that this case, knowing that you are going to work on the diagonal, the long diffuse disease may create a problem. So wire your diagonal, don't do PCI, but wire the diagonal while you're doing the PCI of the LED. Because now your wire is, no matter how you go, it's in some channel. and maybe you can get a whisper.
Why don't we take care of the LED, forget the DAG, and
a whisper or a Pilot 50 probably Pilot, will do the trick. I don't think this is going to make the, but you know, you guys are so talented, you'll probably, you know, get it in there. But I think when you do this and you have issues with this angle, then I think the whisper or a Pilot 50, some kind of you know, wire that can maintain its curve and negotiate and allow you to push.
Why not a double lumen catheter?
Yeah, that is another point, is that should you use you know, that's using a twin pass, bring it and then try to, you know, orientation. It's very difficult. It could be done, but in this particular case where there is not much lumen, where to make curve, you may not be able to see much.
Your Pilot 200, yeah.
Yeah.
The situation also is that the diagonal is that this diagonal has about an 80-90 degree takeoff.
So I think that I agree with George. I think that is the problem. I mean, yeah, dissection a little bit is okay, but that, yeah.
Yeah, your proximal curve is just taking your band away. That's the issue.
So that is what we did now. The fine cross is distal to the diagonal, made a very tight curve, a significant curve. You're there. And then pull back. So now what you do is you have to pull back your distal. Let me magnify. Now it's a whisper.
Okay, good. When I'm about to cross,
you need a whisper.
Change it.
Yeah. No. Okay.
Yeah. Which also made a 90.
Yeah, 90 degree. Very big curve. You know, 1 second. This is lag. It's going to break the machine.
That's what's going through there. AK could wire it.
So. Yeah. Okay.
Wire without fluoro.
Yeah. Good. Whisper. Good.
Okay, good.
Okay. Dark. Okay.
So I essentially made a big 90 degree curve. I think what George mentioned was very clear. See how the diagonal is taking off, or close to, I would say, more than 70 degrees, sure. Close to 90 degrees.
Yeah, or 80 to be a little bit more accurate.
Okay, 80.
Actually, no, it's 82. We just calculated.
And I agree with the wire choice. Exactly. I think we first tried Fielder. Fielder is, again, polymer jacketed wire with a tip load just close to, you know, 4 or so. Then you go with the... Now, why we said run-through? Run-through actually is, you know, the tip is hydrophilic coated, but able to keep the curve. But all this wire that we use right now, they all are not tapered. Neither Fielder is tapered, neither is run-through tapered, neither is whisper. But whisper is a different kind of a polymer jacketed wire. If this does not work, then you can go to, you know, what we would say, go to specialty wires of the CTO, where Pilot, yes, Pilot starts with 50, 150 and 200. We carry 200 only. So that could have been another choice, because then the tip load of the Pilot is slightly higher, which may help us get into this branch, only because it will keep the shape of the wire to get into the side branch. If it still does not work and we think we really need the diagonal to be patent, then of course we have to go to Supercross or Venture to get into the...
Let's start cutting from here.
Okay. I would go with the regular balloon. Go up. One, you definitely, there is, you see it is entangled, the LED wire as well as the diagonal wire. Mm-hmm.
2.512, get it ready.
Okay, good.
We may not need, so key is the same. Anytime when you are advancing your cutting balloons, this is the Wolverine 2.5, in the path, as long as you are in the lesion, maybe not to the final destination, you can cut. I mean, and then it will let you go further.
Go up.
Yeah. And then go 2-3 cuts in different direction. Low pressures, because this is just barely a 2.5 millimeter vessel. Yeah, here, let's cut this.
But the problem is the more proximal portion of the LED, if you want to do a bifurcation strategy, is it large enough to do that?
No, not really. What does a bifurcate say for such a... difficult case that the LED is so diffuse in disease and so long.
Yeah.
How could that help?
Yeah. Okay, so take a picture. Let's take a angio and then decide.
Yeah.
Good idea.
Okay.
Oh.
Wow.
LED has to be taken care. So I would say that use a long. You start seeing a little bit of diastasis, extravasation at the level of the septal. So use a long stent, whether 38 or, I mean, synergy or long, but or
we use Zions.
Yeah.
No, Promus.
You want to stent with the LED or you want to stent with the diagonal?
Right. What?
Yeah, that's another point. No, I think we do a mini crush at that level.
Okay, get us a 38. 2.5 to the LED.
Or 2.5 to the LED or 2.25?
I think it will be a big vessel.
Flow?
2.5 to the LED and what do you think? Diagonal? 2.5, 2.75?
2.5, 12.
Why don't you image it? Do you think imaging here?
I think with the wire entanglement, let's not image. Let's do the bifurcation stent, then image.
I would say the LED go 2.25.
That's 38. One thing. And second
2.25, 38. And 2.75, 12. Okay?
Okay, we'll do that. What is concerning is a little bit of, you see that the dye staining at the level of the large septal?
Yeah.
I think let's not go imaging right now.
Maybe, I mean, I don't know, but it seems a little simpler to take the long stent from Proxel AD 2 and then recross a distal LED or a little kiss balloon or whatever.
Maybe
you
what
do
you have?
The problem is
2.538. You want to use 2.5 low pressure?
You may have
2.5.
Okay, give us.
We have created a dissection in the LED. When somebody has a low EF and we are trying to do PCI, try not to leave dissection because risk of stent thrombosis is very high.
Branch?
I think we should stent that LED with the diagonal and then maybe one stent in the prox LED.
Yeah.
I mean prox to mid LED.
Yeah. Okay, let's do the diagonal 2.75-12. Coming?
So you have a pretty bad tear proximally and past the diagonal.
Exactly. So and what will lengthwise proximally?
That's later. 2.75-38 for the proximal LED.
Okay.
This is okay.
This is the 2.75-12 for the D2 or D3. Same, we are putting in the angulated vessel first, and then we go by
this
LED.
This is what George Bifurcate will tell us, okay, that you go to the side branch or the angulated vessel first. Here, the angulated is the diagonal, so we'll go into the diagonal first. We are taking a 2.75-12 into the side branch.
See? That area needs to dilate a little more. We have the balloon or all
cutting
the
balloon vent. That's the thing, right?
Huh?
This is is just a wire bias.
We can use the same 2.5 balloon 30 which we had. Or no, you need to open that area, and the balloon will actually. Right now it's wrapped.
Wrapped.
Wire tangled. Ready?
Yes. Okay.
Although we did a good cutting balloon, even then.
Cutting balloon went. It's surprising. Cutting balloon went and the stent is not going.
Okay. So key is that with the balloon, we straighten out whatever the entanglement of the wires happening. This will help before we get the stent. Good.
This is a 2.5-30?
Yeah. Connect and go negative. Yeah, this is the point I was saying to Arthur earlier, that all these floppy wires, they do go, but then they just don't provide enough support. Yeah, let's open it here.
Hmm. Go.
Okay.
So maybe change it out an all-star.
The whisper is a motor support wire, so I think the support is decent. I think your wires might be wrapped.
Hmm.
Because this should go.
Definitely that.
There you go.
Good. Okay. Give it a part.
Just
take two. Now we are going to try again.
Yeah, try this balloon again.
Yeah.
think there's stent
here. Yeah, here, yes, right?
Yeah. Also, I can feel the calcium spicules, the moderate calcium that we thought was there. Arthur Reitman wanted considering rota.
I mean, the key is that first, the
just for preservation of the diag. That was all I was asking.
Yeah. Good. Okay. All right. Take two.
Different that you need to do when you have little issues here and there. So very good illustration of, you know, how to
lesion preparation even to get deliver the stent.
And other question is, in this case, you want to use a guideliner, nothing wrong in that too. You
I
can
think
have a seven French guideliner.
Seven French with the two stents will be hard with double wires.
Seven French, because remember the guide is seven. Six is trouble, seven will take it.
That would be another mode of atherectomy if you take the seven French guideliner all the way down there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No. You're not holding the wire.
That's right.
Good. Okay, very good. Benton.
We have to apply brakes.
Okay.
Good. Now let's go to, now let's make sure the
LED will go.
No.
Now let me ask you, maybe ask the panelist or opinion. Would you have used the synergy knowing that it's a little more deliverable in this complex case? And what are the data feel? Some people feel synergy may have a little higher acute thrombosis. That has been the burns, the data registry. We actually published ourselves, we didn't find. But there are some still, some issues, some people do talk about that maybe having a higher either acute stent thrombosis with a synergy because it's a bare, like no covering. Into the abluminal surface. I mean, to the luminal surface.
Really?
Yeah. Remember the Burns registry showed that there is higher acute. Because reason is that, remember, there is no coating on the luminal surface because coating is on the abluminal surface. So no resistant coating. So that was editorial also, along with that, in the Sripal Bangalore saying that it is all because it was just kind of a bare metal stent.
So do we just leave this here and then take care of proximal and distal later?
Yeah.
Because
that's fine. If we cannot get further, that's good. Yeah. That's okay.
Complex case.
Let's pull the wire. Yeah.
There is deformation.
But we did not find.
Hold on.
But I just want to say. Huh?
Which is side branch?
Side branch is here. This one. Yeah.
No. The stent.
There. Yeah.
Okay.
So key. So we did actually in our series, we published in CCI. We didn't find any difference in terms of restenosis or acute stent thrombosis with the synergy. But there are like few. We did not. But okay. There are some.
You want to go up?
Report of. Yeah. I think it's okay.
Some
ready?
Die.
Good.
So for the side branch.
In the LED.
Yeah, right now we do. If need to go further, we go further. Yeah. Later, yeah.
Okay.
Good. 12, 14.
That's it. Negative. It's 2.75.
No.
Go one more.
Okay. Yeah. 12. Okay, down.
Okay. Now we'll do the same that we are going to pull back both the wire and the balloon.
Give me a new fielder wire to recross here, okay?
Yep. Good.
Okay, go up. Main vessel. George wanted to leave the distal LED anyway.
12.
So the stent.
Well, we'll do a little massage.
Yeah.
Now I'll tell you the Sharma's stent technique of with the balloon. So you go a little distal. Yeah, we'll show this one now. Okay, let's see if we can get balloon further of the. Keep going as much as possible or no? But you have to go negative first. 1 second. This we can remove. Okay, see if we can go further. This wire we can remove. Wire and balloon. Yeah, take out both. Wire and balloon. So side branch is out. So see
wire everything is entangled. Yeah, very bad.
That is the reason. So what if we just take the wire out first? Let's hope our LED wire has not come back.
No.
Good. Okay.
It's not moving.
It's not going to go. Okay, that's fine. Let's take it out. We are done here. Good.
Okay, let us see.
You want to know? We'll give you a little knife ride. Okay.
So far, so good.
So far, yeah. It will require a little bit of massage of the for the distal vessel. Let's do this and then we put a proximal stent.
No, put a proximal stent right now.
Okay.
There's a lot of dissection.
Good. So we get
now, distally, do you want to take care with the stent or leave it?
No, that we'll see. Maybe just balloon and medication as has been pointed out and so, yeah.
Get us, what stent you want proximal now? Length, 28?
Do it good.
Yeah.
Okay, so because that's the only time we left with now. 24 or 28?
24. 3 or 24?
Yeah.
3-5.
I think you have good flow now. I think, yeah. You know, do the proximal area and then maybe image. And the distal, yeah. I think you might have a landing zone. There might be plaque after the stent with a poor runoff. So you might need another there. So I think
what is the
I
balloon
would do
we
this.
Have? Two balloons.
And then figure out distal and then recross in case, I guess.
Yeah.
Is that what you plan?
That's right.
Yes,
that is correct.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So we have 5 minutes, guys.
Yep. We should be done at least from the stenting point of view.
Okay, get me the wire. Okay, if the guy does not have it, yeah, huh? Right.
You have
otherwise,
it.
Remember, it will be difficult to cross. Proximally, we'll put a stent, so it'll be easier to recross again. Then. Then I think we'll recross KISS vasodilators and decide to go if we need to go for the distal vessel. 2 or 30 balloon?
Yeah, distally.
Absolutely. You guys keep on walking. Take your time. We're going to have 5 minutes here and then we'll break to PK's case.
Yep. They're getting ready also. We should be done here in just about 5 minutes. Yeah.
Any other questions regarding the steps of bifurcation?
And before we go on, just give us 1 minute because Annu will like to show the latest one coming in her app market. Just 1 minute. Would so give us 1 minute before.
The end, correct?
And the end, yeah. So 4 minutes later and we'll just do. Lil Dai. So yeah. Let's see.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
For those of you who don't know, Dr. Keeney has made his apps for bifurcation, which is very,
excellent.
Very
interactive. Go a little bit?
I think we're good, no?
With us.
Yeah.
No, septal we'll lose.
Yeah, that's okay. Good.
Good.
Go up. Good. Yeah, negative. Balloon is ready.
Go up again. I'm going in between. This is for the 30
one
distal.
One second.
Yeah. Now, recross, I will go with the fielder first. That is, polymer jacketed wires or hydrophilic wires are the best wire to recross.
Good.
Wow. And then. Good.
Yeah.
Before anything else, you've got to do a high pressure balloon.
AKSS, every time you inflate, the pulse pressure narrows. I bet there's more viability here than...
I think so. I definitely think that way, yes. Good.
Okay, now we are going to go to the distal area, long balloon, right?
Yep.
And then if it looks good, we just recross KISS.
Yeah.
Okay. So, good.
Let's dilate this one, then that's the time we left with. And if required, we can give vasodilator distally, but that's okay. I don't think we need to go distal. Vasodilator just to the guide catheter will be good enough. We actually have a side-by-side another case of Impala going on, another complex case, which my associate Barman, Nitin Barman, is doing. Yep.
So will you leave the
good.
No, yeah. I think we'll take it out here. Yeah.
Take it out.
You know, the leaving impella is indication only if they are in a shock, and you know, if they're presented acutely with shock, because the risk of vascular complication when they go outside is very high. And always you prefer to do removal also under fluoroscopy to avoid any vascular injury.
And tack up with a balloon, you go to your 8 atmosphere or 10, whatever, and then go down to half. Very simple. So basically, whatever the cracks you have created, the tacks up at the lower pressure. You keep same 8 or 10, they will propagate. So that is the balloon point of view. There is further disease downstream. We'll just stop here, pull back. Let's take a picture and go to the app.
Go here. Okay, down.
Let's go.
Very important, because it's a bifurcation stenting. Yeah. It's complex. It's long. You got to have good runoff. And that's why I think doing that angioplasty, seeing what's happening distally, is very important. Otherwise, you are running the risk of stent thrombosis. So this is a very important step.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Look at
Agree,
that.
Agree, guys?
Born.
We just have to go back to the slides. We'll do a final kiss later. Okay. And you want to just take your
I just wanted to go over this apps that we have created. That is, you can see the website we have, which is cardiologyapps.com. Bifurcate app is the one which you guys were discussing. The first app that came out almost 7 years ago, illustration of all the steps of the various bifurcation technique for left main and non-left main. It's just a beautiful illustration. Then we came up with the Octade, which is just an OCT, indication for OCT. We have beautiful pictures of OCT. Then we have a quiz as well as cases where you can learn how the OCT images actually in the various cases. Then actually came out was a tower cathode, where we know once we started doing tower, reaxis was way harder. So actually we had a JACC publication followed by this particular app, which actually a second version just came out a few weeks ago. You can download. We have a lot of case reviews, because what I get from most people is they like to watch cases. They like to learn cases. So showing guide selection, how to, and there are beautiful animations to see how to engage once your tower is there. You see beautiful animations that we have created. Transeptate was when we started, when mitral clip came into existence, is how to do transeptal successfully for various mitral procedures. Then, of course, that's what Arthur, you were asking, calcificate, how to, take care of calcific lesion, indication when to use rota, OA, and laser atherectomy. And now we'll have to upgrade it again, since IVL has come into the market. We have to upgrade this into second version. Complicate is called as a web app. It is just a website. There are about 800 angiograms. The various complications that we see in the cath lab, everything has been nicely classified, and all the complication, when the complication happens, how to diagnose them, how to manage them, everything step by step, description of each case of the various complication that we see in the cath lab for us in the daily basis. Next.
And we'll finish in 30 seconds now. And these are the, sorry, 1 second, just quickly. What is coming now for everybody?
Yeah, the Guidewire app is something that will be coming up in the next, I would say, month or so, is exactly description of the various wires, which wire for which particular condition. And Bifurcate 3D, STEMI app is a communication platform, which will need a big lecture to say what it is, but it will be coming out soon. But Bifurcate 3D, if you can show the next picture. This is right now, the website is available. Whatever we showed here is in a 3D form animation. This is the animation. Yeah. You see there? This is just a DK crush technique of the left main, just showing you how it happens. So various technique of left main, non-left main, that is available, that you can see with various animation rather than just the illustration, which was the first Bifurcate app. And this particular web app, this one, there is a website. We've created the Bifurcation Club for Sky. The Sky has created a website for the Bifurcation Club, Bifurcation Club of the Sky. Okay. And we have connected this website into the Sky website. So even you can go to Sky website and access all this animation. Now, these animation videos are beautifully done here in Mount Sinai by my associate here, Andrew. And then what have this is free to download. Anybody can go there and download it and use for educational purpose for your lectures or whatever. But, you know, we have to be, it has to be free, and give credit to ICANN School of Medicine.
And Jaswinder, thank you very much for giving us the opportunity for showing this case, which we always try to go step by step in such a complex case. I think it was appropriate based on your complex symposium, complex meeting you carry, and your master in it. And hopefully we, our audience learned from it, and we thank you, your arch organizers and our panelists. To be very interactive for last 48 minutes. We are a few minutes above, but thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Fantastic. Thank you very much. You guys look amazing in the hat too. The arch hat looks good on you guys.
Yes, that's true. We are going to copy this one in our CCC symposium in June. Yes. We already told Kim, yes, she has to make it exactly like this.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So excited about it. Thank you. That's what.